Miss Kalpana, please stop sharing your screen.
Suniva, just remove her from the screen. And kindly do not add again.
Welcome all for this afternoon session. We have given limited entries to Google Meet due to huge participation. We have two rooms apart from Google Room, that is YouTube Live and Facebook Live Room. For starting the session, we are starting with Shanti Mantra. For this, I invite Sakshi Pachauri. Sakshi, can you hear me? Sakshi.
Oh yes, am I can.
Now you can start.
Good afternoon, all. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, Sakshi.
Okay. Om Dyau Shanti Antariksham Shanti. पृथ्वी शांतिरापः शांतिरोषधयः शांतिः वनस्पतयः शांति विश्वे देवः शांति ब्रह्मा शांतिः सर्वं शांति शांतिरेव शांतिः सामा शांतिरेधि ओम शांति शांति शांति. धन्यवाद.
मीनिंग ऑफ शांति मंत्र. मे हार्मनी ट्रांसमिट देयर इन द एंटायर स्काई जस्ट एज इन द ट्रेमेंडस इथरल स्पेस ऑल ओवर द प्लेस. मे हार्मनी रूल्स ऑल ओवर दिस वर्ल्ड इन वाटर एंड इन ऑल हर्ब्स एंड क्रीपर्स. मे हार्मनी स्ट्रीम ओवर द एंटायर यूनिवर्स. May harmony be in the supreme being Brahma. Also may there consistently exist in all harmony and harmony alone. Om harmony, harmony and harmony to us and all creatures. With this, I welcome Dr. Vandana Batra, who is going to chair today's session. She is associate professor in Department of Physics of Bhaskaracharya College of Applied Science. Her teaching experience includes 25 years up to BU. She did her PhD from Delhi University on high energy cosmic rays ions aboard NASA LDEF, which was deployed in Earth orbit by Space Shuttle Challenger. Her research areas include semiconductor physics also, and she was a principal investigator for developing an intelligent, eco-friendly multi-layer packaging and nutritious snack from fruits and vegetable seeds and peas. Under DU Innovation Project scheme, she developed nanotechnology lab in college and worked as coordinator for DST Star College scheme on behalf of Physics Department of Bhaskaracharya College. She contributed 14 research papers in national and international journals and conference reading. She is life member of Nuclear Track Society of India and CGNC Advanced Green Chemistry. She is working on a project of mapping and determining rotational speed of Milky Way galaxy. Over to you, ma'am. Vandana, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Purnima, for a nice introduction. Good afternoon, Principal Ma'am, Dr. Charu Sharma, guest speakers, Professor Kulshreshtha, Professor Poonam, young scientist, and my dear friends. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers to give me an opportunity to be a part of this international virtual conference. It was thoughtful of research cell as well as community engagement and outreach cell team members under the guidance of Principal Ma'am, Dr. Charu Sharma, for organizing an international conference on science, people, environment, and pandemic, that is Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. Truly, the whole world is facing a challenge due to novel coronavirus. WHO named it SARS-CoV-2, and the disease due to this is COVID-19. This session will explore the role of physics in this pandemic situation. Physics-based tools and technology are playing a very crucial role in this situation. As physicists, we know first step is to understand problem, that is to learn what is the structure of novel coronavirus, where X-ray crystallography is used for getting 3D detailed structure of the virus. Then second step is to learn how to fight against it, that is to learn where we have to attack this virus to disable its effects. There, electron microscopy comes for resolving detailed structure of spike protein in this virus. PhD degree in 1979 from University of Delhi on quark, anti-quark potential model and heavy quark physics, and did postdoctoral from University of Kaiserslautern, Germany. He then held a 5-year position of a UGC research scientist of India at the University of Delhi, duration of 1986 to 91, followed by a 5-year position at the University of Kaiserslautern, Germany, before being appointed a professor at the University of Delhi in 1994. Professor Kulshreshtha remained a professor at the University of Delhi until 2016, serving as head of the Department of Physics and Astrophysics during 2007 to 2010. Since 2011, he was several times visiting faculty in the Nuclear Physics Theory Group at Iowa State University and at University of Oldenburg. Professor Kulshreshtha is a well-known theoretical physicist, and his research focuses on formal aspects of quantum field theory, string theory, and general relativity. In particular, he studies the canonical structure constraint in actions using Hamiltonian and path integral formulation, as well as the BRST quantization. He also studied exotic stars, boson stars, boson shells, black holes, and wormholes in general relativity, and his work was profiled by the American Physical Society's Physics Central site also. He is a member of International LightCon Advisory Committee and helped in organizing 2012 International Conference on LightCon Physics at the University of Delhi. Professor Kulshreshtha has written over 60 scientific articles, which have received over 400 citations. Please welcome Professor Kulshreshtha. The topic of first plenary talk is pandemic and science. Over to you, sir. Professor Kulshreshtha, please.
Sir, you have to unmute yourself. I'll check, sir.
Hello. Hello.
Ma'am, there is, I think, some technical problem. Unka unmute nahi ho raha hai. I'm just trying to unmute him so that he can start the presentation.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible, but sir, ka jo video is an issue.
Ma'am, I request you, kindly go ahead with next speaker. Till then, I will call him and get in touch with him. But technical problem is happening. So let us go to the next session. Ma'am is already here. Poonam ma'am is already here. So, Vandana ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Now you are audible.
Oh, perfectly fine. That's fine. Well, if you like,
Sorry for the inconvenience, sir.
No. This is perfectly fine. Vandana ji, is it okay? Fine now. Is everything fine?
Yes, sir. Yes, you are audible as well as visible. Please.
Okay. So, I suppose I take off. All right. So let me first extend my thanks to my old friend, Dr. Vandana Batra, who is the chairperson, for such a nice introduction, such a nice kind words about me. And then, obviously, I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Purnima, Dr. Vishal, Dr. Charu Sharma, and in fact, the entire distinguished faculty of your Bhagini Nivedita College. In fact, I remember about 10 years ago, I have been to your college. And when I came, it was springtime and it was surrounded by beautiful flowers all around. Some mustard yellow flowers were there all around. So I have very beautiful memories about your college. With that, let me come now to the topic of my talk. I'm grateful to Dr. Vishal Chaudhary for having agreed on this topic of pandemic and the role of science. As Vandana ji just said, by training I'm a theoretical physicist. I love the scientific methods actually, which are applicable not only to theory but to experiments everywhere. And if the mankind tries to follow some of them, it would be really good for the mankind. But before I do that, let me first come back to the theme of your conference, which is, I like to repeat, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. And from my early school days, I remember my Sanskrit teacher was extremely great. And he made me recite several Sanskrit slokas, and this was one of them. So I like to complete it. Ayam paroveti ganana lagu chetasam udara charita naam tu vasudhaiva kutumbakam. I remember it from my early school days. So, we treat, by training as a scientist, we treat the entire world is actually our mother. The entire mother earth is our family. It's just inculcated into our culture. And then the role of science and the pandemic. So before I mention something about pandemic, let me first talk about science, which in Hindi is called Vigyan. And I like to quote one of my most favorite poets, Goswami Tulasidas. He says in Ramcharitmanas, Gyani hute mohi priya Vigyani. Gyani is somebody who has knowledge, and Vigyani is a Vaigyanik, a scientist who tries to see the things, visualize the things in a scientific manner. And now with this reference, I come back to the topic of this talk. So in the first place, the pandemic. And here it may be worthwhile to recap that we talk or listen about viruses, various viruses, and if they develop a little bit further into some, they spread a little bit, we start calling it epidemic. And if it spreads at very, very large, huge scales, we call it pandemic. So, I mean, there have been several examples in the past, beginning from small viruses to epidemics and to coming to this unfortunate COVID-19 that we are currently facing, the entire mankind is facing throughout the globe. Here now, as Dr. Vandana mentioned, something on physics, although my topic is much wider, but I, as a physicist by training, so I like to come back to first year physics. In first year, I remember I have taught in Rajdhani College for a couple of years, and I used to teach first year mathematical physics, where there was a paper on theory of errors, and there was a propagation of errors, theory of the propagation of errors. And then we go to first year lab, whether it is honors or pass course does not matter. You have these very, very ordinary experiments, which are extraordinary, but they look like ordinary based on properties of mechanics and so on. And there, I like to quote an example of the coefficient of viscosity, measurement of the coefficient of viscosity. So you have a long tube, something like half a meter or 1 meter long, water is flowing through this capillary tube. And if you measure the length of this tube, its least count would be 0.1 centimeter. But the radius of the capillary tube, inner radius of the capillary tube, is of the order of a few thousand, one thousandth of a centimeter. So you measure it with a traveling microscope, the scale measures up to 0.11 centimeter. And you see the formula for this coefficient of viscosity, it involves fourth power of this radius of this capillary tube, and the length of the tube appears just with raised to the power 1 only, or minus 1, it doesn't matter. Then so you calculate the without even touching the theory of errors, you just talk about log errors. Every teacher teaches, every student learns at the first year level. Very first thing that we do in our lab is to learn. So how do the errors propagate in our further calculations and measurements that affect our work? This is so relevant in this present context of pandemic. You see, it may not be in our hands most of us cannot control the origins for these viruses. Maybe some great people could do it. So the origin of the virus, then the next question is the spread of the virus. Now, what theory of error has to do with it? It's the most significant thing in life. In fact, that is why we teach it in first year. So if we make a small error in the measurement of the radius of the capillary tube, which is 0.11 centimeter, you see, and then it's raised to the power 4. So you can estimate how much errors would propagate further. Okay, if you make minor mistakes in the measurement of the length of the tube, it might not matter so much. Okay, so now this virus takes the shape of an epidemic. It later on might take shape of a pandemic. So a global outbreak of a disease. That is what has just now happened with this corona virus and with this. So my point was, as I quoted a line from Ramacharitmanas, that it's good to be a gyani, it's good to be knowledgeable, but we could still do better if we become a vigyani, a vaigyanik, a scientist, which means we don't need a PhD degree in physics or chemistry or zoology or botany. No, by no means. Even a person who is ploughing in the field could be a scientist. So scientist, it's a way of scientific thinking that we need to develop. How to handle our situation, given situation, how can we best handle it scientifically? So we need a scientific mind, scientific thought, scientific methods. You see, I will quote a few examples. And so you see, you can at each step, you can distinguish between good science and bad science, good medicines and bad medicines. You see, if you perform the experiment of this that I mentioned, coefficient of viscosity, you write everything in the practicals lab and so on. I have examined the students too. But if the student does not know how to correctly read the scale of the traveling microscope, scale which reads up to 0.001 centimeter, then we are doing extremely bad science. You see, it's going to create disasters. And this is what exactly is happening in the present situation, you see. So we need to be correct in the very first place. Unless I teach the student how to read the traveling microscope scale correctly, there is no point in calculating what is coefficient of viscosity. Okay, you are bound to get completely wrong results. And the same situation is true for this present pandemic that unfortunately the whole mankind is facing. I wish it were not there, but if it's now there, we have to face it. How do we face it best? We have to approach the, make the scientific approach. In this context, about a month ago, when I was looking, you see, in the, all of us know about this, I hardly believe on the TV news channels. It can be fake, it can be irresponsible reporting and many things. Some of our speakers have highlighted on this. So, but you just look into your mobile, write coronavirus, Germany, coronavirus, India, US, UK, and you go to the worldometer and you read the different things, how it is being studied in that country. So in India, you see, if the number of new cases you study in India, in the first month or month and a half, the angle was, you see, only something 20 to 30 degrees, you see, between this line, if you approximate it to a straight line. And if you take the data only on from the last 1 month, and then if you approximate this curve, I'm talking with respect to India, Indian data, then this straight line would have a slope of something like 60 degrees. It's so alarming, my goodness. It's so risky, so dangerous. What are we doing? We are going to create a hell on in our country if we are so irresponsible. You see, here this reminds me, coming back to science again, this reminds me of this French mathematician, Mr. Descartes, who introduced this Cartesian system of coordinates. Then there is a whole lot of a statistical analysis. He introduced it right in the first year, not without calling it a statistical analysis or a statistical mechanics, but you do introduce the mean deviation, standard deviation, and these things, and calculation of errors and so on. In our log error, everybody would remember how you calculate these things and what do they do for you. So plotting of these curves is an important scientific idea. Plotting of histograms, you look at the barometer. Germany happens to be my second home. You look into the barometer of Germany, and right now it is important in the context because it is one of the most successful countries in the world. It has set up an example that they can claim that, yes, we have won the corona war. How? We look into their, so in the first place, almost no country has got so many analytic results there that Germany has. I would request and recommend that everybody should have a look after this session into this barometer readings of Germany versus other countries, especially with respect to India. Not to talk of US and UK, they have been in a very terrible situation. But we could be in a worst situation if we are careless, you see. So we have to look at these various data. Medical teams go around the homes in Germany. My German friends tell me they collect the correct data. I mean, not only that, some XYZ, you just ask some school teachers or some clerks to go around and collect data, how many people live in this building. It is useless. What is the purpose of this? You have to collect from the medical point of view, you see. So the number of new cases, you can calculate number of new cases arising per day, number of how many people are admitted to the hospital, how many people are recovering, how many people have recovered very fast, how many people have died. And all these graphs, analytics, histograms, they are available on this barometer site of this Germany in particular. They have uploaded, they have taken the trouble to do it. Fortunately, they have a Bundeskanzler, the German Chancellor, who is a PhD holder in physics. The friends jokingly tell me that having scientific leadership helps. So we need scientific attitude, scientific mind. That is the reason I have chosen this particular topic for my talk. So you see, In India, we are still not worried. You see, in the tell you about, you see, I'm not showing you any slides. I'm telling you in words and giving you the original source. So you look at the histogram plotted in the worldometer site of Germany. So this tells you, you can approximate it to a Gaussian curve. Okay. So now today, they have something like 8,000 cases, which are currently, they fall in the category of infected. You see, although they had 1.85 lakhs or 185,000, you see, infected cases somewhere 1.5 months ago. You see, so now this Gaussian curve, it comes back to its original shape where it was 2 months or 2.5 months ago in the middle of March, beginning of March, where they were very few, negligible number of cases. They are again back to that same place. So we need to have this scientific analysis of our entire study, entire thoughts, not that we make irresponsible claims. Unfortunately, in India, the people think only in terms of votes. It's completely stupid. You see, you have to think in terms of the mankind, what the service you are giving. And this, therefore, you will develop a scientific temperament, scientific attitude, scientific methods you would follow. Not some arbitrarily, hamare yahan to bahut kam maut hui hai. This is stupid nonsense. We are 130 million people living in our country. We need to have, the most important factor is number of new cases arising per day on the daily basis. Unless you can minimize it to the data that was 2.5 months ago at the beginning of March, you are nowhere near success. Right now, our slope is going at the angle of 60 degrees. Somebody needs to tell these politicians, look at these graphs. This is science. This, they need to look at this. Pandemics can also be handled with the help of science if you develop scientific thought, if you handle it scientifically. Doesn't matter what situation it is. Let it be a worse situation, but we need to analyze, we need to know what are the results. We need to proceed further. So this, like theory of errors, we need to prevent in the first place the origin of the viruses. If it is beyond our hands, as is the case presently, then what we can do is prevent its spread. You see, prevent the spread. And preventing is spread to a global situation, you see. So it doesn't matter if you theoretically claim you put lockdown. There are also various theories in the lockdown, in the longer lockdowns, you can allow minor gaps of few days where the poor people could easily migrate from one place to another place, you see. Each and every life matters. 2/3 of our population is so poor, and we need to worry about it. Yes, I am for the lockdown, extensive period lockdowns, but we could have intermittent gaps where the people could migrate from one place to another, you see. They are facing complete hardships. Maybe the news are exaggerated. I don't know. I'm not sure. I'm unfortunately not a journalist. It's good that I do physics and science. It's free of tensions. Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, actually, we are running short of time. Although it is always pleasure to hear from you, especially theory and theory of errors and its calculation. Please make a brief note.
Yes, I thank you so much, Vandana ji, for reminding me. Let me take just one important point that I like to mention is about the remedial or medicinal aspects of this. Here, I don't want to forget, even at the cost of running short of time, that there are some medicines which are called as folk remedies. And these are very, very crucial. This everybody knows in the household, which is called kala. Tulsi, adrak, kali mirch, haldi, you see, all these things in your own way. And let me tell you, it's not a matter of laughing. Almost every year I go to Germany, I spend almost more than 8 years there at different times. If you go to the restaurants, they put a pot of flowers on your table, dining table. And I find that they put the, in summers or spring times, they put a pot with basilic. Basilic is our tulsi. Tulsi has is available in almost 50 varieties. You see, you can buy this bunch for 1 euro. You can take it home. Put this little flower pot on your dining table at home. You can pluck a few. It's not a thing of worshipping. It's a thing to be used. You see, so tulsi or basilic, basilicum in various forms, it's available. It's called, you mix it up in your own fashion with black pepper or ginger or turmeric or whatever you like. So we should not, and this as the medicine source, I am almost nearly ending my talk. So it is the medicines, the doctors also, they want to go in for the evidence-based medicinal treatment. I am not a medicine expert. I almost know nothing on in the field of medicines. But in the first place, prevention is better than cure. And we must not forget our home remedies, folk remedies as they are called. And because they have they are evidence-based for hundreds and thousands of years. So with that, I think I have more or less covered my main important points, except the last one, which I would like to convey, that the times are extremely difficult that the mankind is facing. And on behalf of myself and on behalf of this conference, all the participant delegates, I would like to recite a two-line Sanskrit sloka, which is a prayer from my side for the entire mankind. Sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani pasyantu, ma kaschit dukh bhagavet. I wish that entire mankind remains healthy and happy, and nobody has to become a part of the suffering. With that, I thank all the organizers, Vishal, Purnima, Vandana, and all of you are my students, so I am not putting G every time, and I must have a special thanks to Dr. Charu Sharma. I'm very sure without a dynamic leadership, you cannot do anything. So you need the leader matters. And so my heartfelt thanks to everybody and congratulations to all of you for organizing this. We have already heard important talks in this. I have been hearing some talks and I look forward to hearing some more talks. So all the best and lots of best wishes to all of you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for enlightening us. Next, it is my great pleasure to welcome you, ma'am, Professor Poonam Silotia. Professor Poonam Silotia is Associate Professor at Department of Physics and Astrophysics, University of Delhi. She had joined University of Delhi in year 1992. She received her PhD from University of Delhi on atomic autocorrelation functions in highly anisotropic crystals and simple proteins. She is theoretical physicist in condensed matter physics. Her research area includes atomic autocorrelation function, Bose-Einstein condensation, Fullerness, collective dynamics fluids. She was conferred research associateship of UGC in 1993. She is a member of Indian Association of Physics Teachers and Indian Women's Science Association. Professor Poonam has guided and supervised 6 PhD degree students. Professor Poonam has contributed 25 research papers in national and international conferences and proceedings. Let us welcome Professor Silotia. The topic of second plenary talk is potential of nanotechnology to battle against COVID-19. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Batra. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Batra. And I thank the organizers, particularly Dr. Vishal and Purnima and all the members of the organizing committee who have organized this international virtual conference on science, people, environment, and pandemic. Let me start with it. My topic is potential of nanotechnology to battle pandemics. Currently, the whole world is suffering from pandemic known as COVID-19, novel coronavirus, as termed by WHO. As per Worldometer data, till today, more than 68 lakh people are suffering because of this virus. It has been spread in more than 215 countries worldwide. It was first reported in Wuhan, China, on December 31st, 2019. It is a transmissible virus having approximately size ranging from 90 to 150 nanometer as analyzed from various sources. The source of transmission are different, like airborne, to contact, to non-contact ones. If an infected person sneezes or coughs, and the diameter of droplet nuclei is smaller than 5 micrometer, then it can transmit to things greater than 1 meter through air. And if the diameter is less, then this transmission is within the 1 meter area. Either it is through contact or non-contact mode. There are 3 challenges associated with this pandemic, which includes prevention, detection, and treatment. Now, where does nanotechnology comes into account? Nanotechnology plays a very important role and possess applications in every field. It has great potential to tackle this pandemic also and to address all the 3 challenges. Let us talk about prevention first. If we talk about prevention, corona can be prevented by using sanitizers, masks, purifiers, vaccines, and PPEs. Now, sanitizers available in market, they are based on alcohol. They possess a problem that the disinfected molecule evaporates very quickly. So they offer protection for hardly a minute or so. After that, suppose you have sanitized your hands, and after that, if the user touches a surface with germs, even after sanitizing the hands, they start carrying virus or bacteria again. But that, now this was about the alcohol-based sanitizers. But if we have nanomaterials, then those nanomaterials can stay on our hand for more than 10 minutes and gives us enhanced protection. Naturally derived nanosystems in the formulation that act as absorbents so that alcohol and hydrogen peroxide molecules are released in slow and sustained manner works for 20 to 25 minutes. Now, face masks, which are most commonly used, they filter 95% of the fine pollutants that are at least 300 nanometer in diameter, referred to as N95 masks. Masks are basically required to protect from airborne or touch transmission of virus into a person. Because even if your hand has got infected, until or unless you put it on your mouth or face, the 2 entries are your mouth and nose. So if you don't touch it, then it doesn't affect you. Now, nanofiber membranes, here the nanotechnology comes. Nanofiber membranes, they are made up of dense spider web-like network of nanofibers, and they provide high surface area. So these nanomembranes, they are incorporated into respiratory masks, which provide high breathability and filter efficiency, thanks to their strength and durable structure. There are more masks available which can prevent up to 100 nanometer small particles, and these masks are based on nanocarbon cellulose technology. And these things are under trial by CIEST research team. They have not yet come, but research is going on. Similarly, nanotechnology-based air purifiers, which are based on nanomembrane technology, they can come as a potential candidate to prevent from corona. Now, generally, PPE kits, which we have seen the doctors wearing and other persons who are serving the community, they are wearing, they are not antiviral. They are just the some membrane. But if we put antiviral coating on it, and those antiviral coatings are of new nano-based material, so they can be used in PPE kits, our personal protective equipments, and it can also be used to prevent corona. DST has started, it has called an initiative to design such advanced PPE kits under Nano Mission Initiative. Since the virus is of nano range, the nanotechnology possesses huge role in the formation of vaccine. There is extensive research going on for corona vaccination based on nanotechnology. Now comes diagnosis. Diagnosis may, we have a paper in ACS Nano, which is 14th volume and page number 3822 this year only. It is, the title is Diagnosing COVID-19, the Disease and Tools for Detection. It has described current diagnostic methods. For example, nucleic acid and composed tomography testing. I'm not aware much of it, but it says these are the diagnostic techniques. And one more possible new approach they are saying is protein and point of care testing. These are again based on the nanotechnologies. When nanoparticles enter a biological system, for example, human blood, they come into immediate contact with the biomolecules such as proteins. These biomolecules form a coating layer on the nanoparticle surface and so-called biomolecular corona, thereby imparting a unique biological identity to the nanoparticle, which could be very different from the pristine nanoparticle surface. So this is from the website, the source is NanoWorks Spotlight. So one can, for diagnosis purposes, can be used. Also, there are studies on optical sensors based upon surface plasmon resonance to detect coronavirus by using technology. Lot of research is going on. So one can prevent it, one has to diagnose it, and then one has to treat it, the third thing. So for the treatment, it consists of extensive research, drug delivery, medicine and ventilators based on nanotechnology to cure corona. Due to large effective surface area, nano-based drugs can cure corona more rapidly due to high reactivity and can also act drug delivery agent. So thus, there is a huge potential in nanotechnology to fight against COVID-19. We just need a right direction to get it. Thank you. And I thank the principal who have supported the organizing team, Dr. Charu Sharma, so that this has come into effect. Thank you so much. Thanks.
Thank you, ma'am. I think the whole world is looking towards the nanotechnology with hope, because from the physics-based tools, we can diagnose the structure. But for the vaccine part, nanotechnology is there.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thanks.
Now the session is open for questions and answers. So over to Dr. Vishal, please.
This question is for nanotechnology session to Poonam, ma'am. It's from YouTube Live. Can gold nanoparticles also be used to destroy the structure of coronavirus like Ebola?
Look, I am not an expert in this, but definitely the researches are going on. Gold nanoparticles, I cannot say yes or no at this time because all these I have just taken from the literature. So, what exactly it can do or it can't do, right now, I don't think anybody who has tested it or can answer this.
Yes, sir. And there is one more question from Facebook Live. How does this surface to volume ratio increases in nanostructures? This is a question of a student that how does why nanostructures are so important?
Nahin, always when surface to volume ratio is more, then it can absorb the things better. So whether you have to detect it or you have to treat it. So for that, like what we do, suppose general example I want to tell you, suppose you take a log, chota sa lakdi ka tukda if you take, and you want to burn it, it takes a lot of time. But if you make it burada, powdered form or slightly that, it easily catches combustion and other things are there because that ratio becomes large. So it can help. In that is what I can infer from the literature.
Thank you so much, ma'am. These are the questions from Facebook Live and YouTube Live. Thank you so much for like so informative talk.
Thank you. And a very good platform. When you asked me to do it, then I could see, okay, let me see what are these things. Otherwise, so N95 pe 95 kyun hai? Nobody knows. 995 naam hai to hai. So, thank you so much for calling me and inviting me for this. Thanks.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Vishal, is there any question from for Professor Kulshrestha? Please ask.
Yes ma'am. This question is for Kulshrestha. Sir, what should be the strategy of government in view of science to tackle COVID-19? Sir, am I audible to you?
Sir, please unmute your thing.
We have to unmute.
Yes, sir, please unmute your...
Unmute. It's not unmute, sir.
We have to unmute. Mic option, we have to unmute yourself.
Yeah.
No, we are not able to. Sir, unmute. Unmute it, please.
Okay, I think...
Yes,
you are audible, sir.
Okay, great. So let me first thank you for this very intelligent question. Actually, it's very much needed, so relevant in the present times. You see, I often receive emails from the Prime Minister's office, but I don't have a platform where I can respond back. You see, there are many bubbling thoughts. So, I mean, in the first place, it's not only me, it's a team of young, bright people like you, active people like you. Government in the very first place needs to invite a larger coordination and cooperation from our younger people. You are able to organize this conference without any funding. You see, they should be given an opportunity and responsibility to interact and do something for the nation. You see, they would be very, very useful. They can do this job that I just mentioned in the context of Germany going. It's not enough to send not in the bad sense, but you see, some people come to just ask how many people live in this house. It doesn't help. You have to have some bright young research students like you who would go and with some prepare a proper questionnaire, collect some proper sampling data, do this analysis. Who will do it for the government? The government officials, they are bound with their official duties. Netas and leaders and ministers, they have no time. Who has time? Invite the young, bright researchers from various fields. I have been hearing your talks from Professor B.K. Jain, from yesterday's talk from Professor Kang. It is so informative. And here you need the help. I could not, this is my first online interaction. You see, unless you had not guided me, I would not do it. So you need the younger pool of talent of the younger bright people. Give them some guidelines. They would work in this exactly. We need to create for our country all this data just on par with what they have in Germany. Number of new cases arising every day. You see, you have medical teams. I agree. They are dedicated, but the poor guys, you see, they have to work on evidence-based medication. They cannot arbitrarily try some new medicine. Now, I have been hearing earlier there was this hydroxychloroquine, right? And which our prime minister exported a lot to various countries, several tons of it. Then I read recently there is another called Remdesivir. I don't know how to call it correctly. It's Remdesivir, Remdesivir. It is in the last 1 week, it is racing against going ahead of this hydroxychloroquine. So doctors, but they would like to go, like I would not recommend any of these because I'm not an expert, but as I could do for POC remedies, like home remedies. So these things, you see, we need to recognize. And in the very first place, we need to collect the data. If students know how to do it better, they can create beautiful graphs, beautiful histograms, beautiful statistical analysis of there is so how many new cases, and we have to arrive. Our aim has to be in India, we are nowhere near Gaussian curve, unfortunately. If it is Gaussian, it is on the first rising part, unfortunately. I'm so sorry. Please do have a look at these graphs of India versus Germany. Number of new cases. So in the middle of April, Germany also was at the peak of this Gaussian curve, you see. So, and now they are where they were 2.5 months ago, you see, at this asymptotic limit, where this Gaussian graph meets the axis of X, number of days, you see. And the number of events, number of infections arising every day is on the Y-axis. So if it were, let us say, 10 or 20 or 100, we have come back to that again. How many people are infected? How many people are admitted in the various hospitals? Germany is doing it without any cost. I don't know what they give to these volunteers. These are young research students who collect this data, do this data analysis. I'm very sure people get impressed with their work. They can go to the high up in the ladder. But we need to exploit our talent. We have plenty of talent, young talent in our country. They have to do all these things. How many deaths are there? That's a bad indication. Germany may be 8,000 deaths, India may be 8,000 deaths. This is nonsense. In number of new cases per day, kitne aa rahe hain hamare? Kya wohi 500 aa rahe hain? Aaj to bahut explosion ho gaya hai. Aaj abhi afternoon ki morning ki news mein to it's spikes. It's going up. Agar 60 degree ke angle se koi straight line badhegi, to phir bhagwan hi maare ke kya hoga. और इनमें से तमाम लोग पता नहीं कहाँ कहाँ पहुंच जाएंगे, विलेज में पहुंच जाएंगे, छोटे बड़े सब शहरों में पहुंच जाएंगे. हमारे पास इतनी सुविधा भी नहीं है, फैसिलिटीज भी नहीं है, हम कैसे ट्रीट करेंगे बताइए. तो आप ये क्वेश्चंस, आई थिंक यू ट्रांसफर सम ऑफ दीज आंसर्स एंड क्वेश्चंस टू प्रोफेसर कांग फॉर एग्जाम्पल, टू प्रोफेसर आई डोंट प्रोफेसर बी के जैन माइट बी एबल टू कम्युनिकेट टू सम अदर पीपल. सो टू रेलिवेंट पीपल वेर एवर वट एवर रिसोर्स यू मस्ट पोस्ट योर दीज ऑल दीज थिंग्स investigations, studies of this 3 days workshop. You must give it a wide publicity and with some, I would also tell my friends in my own way, but we need to, everywhere, you see, we need to exploit and make use of our younger talent. That is the first way.
Agreed, sir.
Without your help, we cannot proceed further. We cannot progress. Yes. In any field, you need the young pool of young, bright people like you people. Then we can progress, you see. And you must try to find opportunities of communicating the findings, studies, conversations of your 3 days conference at some platforms. I would also try to. To help in this process. Lots of best wishes to everybody, and lots of thanks and lots of appreciation for all of you who are putting in this hard work. making everybody like namaskar.
Over to thank you, sir. Over to Vishal. Is there any problem? Any question? Sorry.
Ma'am, since we are running short of time, so
So we can post any queries to email.
Sure.
Okay. So now we move to invited young scientist talk segment. First of all, I invite Dr. Pooja Saini from Department of Physics and Astrophysics, University of Delhi. Dr. Pooja Saini, please.
Yes, ma'am. Please wait, I am sharing my screen. So, am I audible to all of you?
Yes, please.
Hello.
Yes, please.
And my screen is visible to all of you?
Yeah. Please continue.
Okay. So, good evening to all of you. First of all, I would like to thank all the organizing committee member of this BN College for providing me this opportunity. So I am very thankful to all of you. So today I will discuss the electronic application of these carbon-based materials. That is just the overview of my research work. And then further, how we can use this, I will propose how we can use these carbon-based materials against this COVID-19. So carbon-based materials basically includes graphite, graphene, diamond, fluorine, and carbon nanotubes. And these materials have a lot of applications in sensor, solar cell, photo detector, photovoltaic, memristor, and many other electronic applications. And but here I'm mainly focusing on graphene and its derivative. Graphene is a monolayer of graphite of 1 angstrom thick. On the other hand, graphene oxide consists of large number of functional groups that are attached at its edges and the basal plane, which make it hydrophilic in nature. So it can be easily dispersed in water and other organic solvents, and we can make its thin film easily by simply spin coating and drop casting technique. And also this graphene oxide can be further reduced by chemically or thermally, due to which the various functional groups get removed, and which is known as reduced graphene oxide. And also due to the presence of this functional group, this graphene oxide can be further functionalized with various organic polymers and gold nanostructures, also carbon nanostructures, etc., and also with enzymes and proteins. So here I will just give the overview of my talk for the electronic application. For the electronic measurement, we are making the structures like metal geometal structure, and for this we are making this is our device structure. This is metal that is ITO coated glass substrate, and then graphene oxide, and then further the top metal contact that is aluminium, which are deposited by using thermal deposition technique through shadow masking. So this first image shows the FECM of this graphene oxide on the ITO substrate, which shows the wrinkle-like pattern of this graphene oxide on ITO. And with annealing at 200, we see that these wrinkles increases, and also the film become more transparent with annealing. And further, these are device structure for measurement of electronic properties. And this is the IV characteristics that we're getting in the IV measurement. When we apply the bias from 0 to 6 and 6 to 0 in forward bias, and 0 to minus 6 and minus 6 to 0 in reverse bias in the sweep cycle, we're getting this switching-like behavior. Like at a particular threshold voltage around 3.5, the current suddenly changes from high to low in forward bias, and in the reverse bias, it is again changes at particular threshold like 0.7 volt from low to high. This high to low state is known as reset, and this low to high is known as set. So this is a switching like behavior that we are getting in our samples, and we have calculated this switching ratio by dividing this on off ratio, and we are seeing that the maximum switching ratio we are getting for 200 degree samples that is nearly 200 degrees Celsius, and the switching ratio is around 10 raised to power 4. And we propose the switching mechanism. We are saying that the switching is mainly coming due to the formation and the rupturing of the filament. Because initially, when we apply the positive bias to aluminium, the current is very high due to the diffusion of aluminium. And at the current is changing from high to low at the point at the interface of GeO-IT interface where the rupturing of filament takes place due to both Joule as well as the Peltier heating. So we're saying, and also this HRTAM image confirmed the presence of filament in our aluminium GeO-ITO structure. And we propose this mechanism that this switching we are getting mainly due to this formation of and rupturing of the filament. And also further, we have measured this resistance of different device structures like aluminium GeO-aluminium, gold GeO-gold and aluminium GeO-ITO and gold GeO-ITO device structures, which this graph shows this variation with annealing temperature. And also, we have functionalized this material with polyalylamine, which also shows that there is difference in current after functionalization with polyalylamine, and there is change in current. And similar with when we functionalize with polyvinyl pyridine, there is again change in current. And also, when we have also made composite of this graphene oxide with gold nanoclusters, which also shows this memristor and memristor kind of behavior. But so I am here mainly focusing on this electronic properties. But there is still need to find the exact physics behind this switching behavior, and also for these devices to use industrialization purpose, we need to find the switching mechanism and reliability of these devices. There is still need to find this mechanism behind that, this device structure. So now I will come to I have gone through a paper that comes in Nano Today, where they have proposed that we can use this graphene-based materials in against COVID-19. Like we can use this graphene material in face mask fabric, air filter, in vivo treatment, diagnostic and drug screening. Where they have proposed that for face mask fabric and other medical equipment, we can coat this graphene layer, and this graphene layer can protect the further transmission of the virus. And also this mask can be reused and recycled by photocatalysis or by heat treatment. And also this graphene filter can be prepared, which where the bacteria can get captured by these filters, and when we heat this filter at 300 degrees Celsius, this graphene filter completely destroyed that microorganism that creating this virus, that are completely destroyed. So we can think like this way, we can make this coating of this graphene on the face mask and make these filters to avoid the further spreading of this coronavirus transmission. And also there is a paper published in 2008 where they have proposed that they have made a biosensor screen printed biosensor by using graphene oxide sample graphene oxide on the textile biosensor. Where they have put this sensor in the textile, and further this is interfaced with flexible electronics, which can locate the positive and identify the source of this virus. So we can also think like this. But in this case, they have detected the virus, that is influenza H1V1 virus. So similarly, they have also proposed that we can also think like we can also make this virus, this textile virus, by using graphene and graphene derivative materials, which can detect this COVID-19 virus, and which can avoid the spreading of this virus further. So, at this time, we can't say that we can use this graphene material at this time. It is unrealistic to use immediate use of this graphene derivative in this COVID-19, because there are certain challenges like the in vivo toxicity of this graphene is certain debatable concept. And also there is the instability.
Excuse me, Dr. Poonam, please, there is a shortage of time.
Yes, ma'am, I'm just concluding. Yeah. Yes,
sure, please.
So, we can also make this graphene, the instability, the in vivo toxicity of this graphene material, as well as the instability and aggregation of this graphene oxide and its derivatives. There are still problem for the use of this material, this COVID-19. But I can conclude that this graphene-based material against this COVID-19 coronavirus. So thank you. Thank you for your kind attention. Be safe and be at home. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Poonam, for such a wonderful work you have done. Is there any question, Dr. Vishal?
Yes, ma'am. There is a question that there are harmful effects of nanomaterials over environment. So how to tackle with them?
Sorry. I am. Please repeat it.
Yeah. There are harmful effects of nanomaterials.
Yes.
Environment.
Yes, that's why I am saying that IMG, this is just proposed idea. We can't use this graphene and other nanomaterial now for against this COVID-19 because the toxicity of this material is also harmful. So I think this is just a view. I am not exactly know what
happens.
It's okay.
Done, ma'am. Over to you.
Okay. Thank you, Vishal. So, as a continuation of Young Scientist Talk segment, I now invite Dr. Manoj Srivastava from DAV PG School, Gorakhpur, UP, in this segment. Dr. Manoj.
Hello. I am
available
to all of you.
Yes, please.
Yeah, very good. Good afternoon to all of you. And I am very, very much thankful to all the organizing committee for giving me chance to deliver my talk. So today I will discuss about the role of magnetites, which are applicable in temperature sensing applications. So hello. Is there any
yes, sir.
Am I doing?
Yes, you are.
Okay. So today I will talk about my work, which is so near to the role of magnetites in temperature sensing applications. My presentation is visible.
Not yet, sir.
Not yet. Is it visible?
No, you have to share your screen, sir.
Yes, sharing.
I would suggest, sir, you can go with your talk, and we will later upload your slides in PDF form. So please mm-hmm. go with your talk.
Is it visible?
No.
I think there's some connection problem.
Yes, sir. Please go with your talk. We will upload your slides for for the audience over the page. So please go with your talk. Since we are running behind the time, please go with your talk.
Okay. No problem.
Now it is presenting. Now it is okay.
Is it okay, ma'am?
Yes, now it is there. But please observe the time.
Okay.
And
sure,
keep it short. So, yeah. Hanji, please.
Okay, sure. Yeah. So today I will discuss about the role of magnetite in temperature sensing applications. So as we know that the whole world is suffering from COVID-19 nowadays, and near about 70 lakh people are suffering from this. So my first talk about why we need to measure the temperature, because first thing you have to measure the temperature of a suffering people. So what will be the characteristic of the temperature sensors? What are the type of sensors? The magnetites. So first I will discuss the need of temperature. Since temperature measurement is a vital part of most industrial applications, and that is typically accomplished by the temperature sensors. So why we need temperature sensing applications? There are various industries where we need to measure the temperature, just like food industry, in which we have to monitor temperature time cycle to ensure high quality of food. Next one is solar energy conversion. In that, accurate temperature measurement to achieve optimal heat flow. Then most important sector is energy efficiency in the home and industry. Measurement of temperature is also necessary. And importantly, the hospital incubator in which the temperature must be kept in a proper range so that there will be no harm of temperature. And one more sector is also very, very important in automobile sector, where the combustion exhaust temperature is important. So there is a desired characteristic for a temperature sensor. They should have accuracy, they should maintain repeatability, they should also have fast response time, they will be easy calibratable, and there should be a relationship between temperature quantity and the quantity and temperature, that is nonlinear or linear. So I will discuss shortly about the type of sensors available in the market. There are various type of sensors available in the market, such as mechanical devices, thermojunctive, in which we can talk about thermocouples, thermoresistive, in which we know two important RTD, just like resistance thermotemperature device and thermistors, and one more which are we using nowadays are radiative type, in which infrared and optical parameters are important. So mechanical devices are also available in the market to measure the temperature, in which we can measure the some kind of mechanical motion, typically due to the fact that most material expand with the rise in temperature. So most of us are using the mercury thermometer, in which there is rise in the mercury with the increasing temperature. So first one is known as liquid in glass thermometer. Second one is bimetallic thermometer, in which there are two bimetallic strip, in which we have two metals A and B, and both have different expansion in the thermal coefficient, and it may be curved. So third one is bulb and capillary sensor. Fourth one is pressure thermometer, in which the pressure can play important role, and with increasing pressure, the temperature may be increased. Second one is thermocouples. A thermocouple is made up of two dissimilar metals joined together at one end. That produces a voltage with the change in the temperature. So these thermometers can be found have various applications, and they have various characteristics like high temperature range. They are inexpensive by cost. They are stand tough environment, maintained from high quality, and they have also fast response. The third quality and the third type of thermometer is available in the market are thermoresistive temperature, in which there are two types, thermoresistive temperature device, which we use in our lab, RTD, and thermistor. RTD is just like operates on the principle of electrical resistance of a metal that changes initially linearly with increasing temperature. So they are also very accurate and stable thermometers, and they are expensive in the cost because they use platinum. They have positive temperature coefficient because temperature rises resistance. As the resistance increases, temperature rises. And second one is thermistor. The thermistor are semiconductor materials. So they are also inexpensive, and they have high sensitivity, and RT resistance thermometer devices are non-linear relationship. Fourth one, which we are using in this COVID pandemic era, this is the infrared pyrometer, which is known as a non-contact thermometer device. Infrared temperature sensors determines temperature by measuring the intensity of energy given by object. So there is a famous formula. We know that Stefan Boltzmann equation E is equal to sigma E T T power 4. And depending upon this formula, we can find the emissivity which are given by the object, and we can measure the temperature. The next one is optical pyrometer, which is useful for measuring high temperature measurement, just like if we want to measure the flames, temperature of flame and the...
Excuse me, Dr. Manoj.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, ma'am. Excuse me, Dr. Manoj. Please leave this slide and come to the conclusion slide. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. So, next one, I am printing my work. Because we are working on the magnetite, and magnetite plays a very important role in measuring the temperature or magnetic field sensors. Because these materials are of ABO3 type perovskite structures, and in which they play a very, very important role, because they shows a very competition, a strong competition between charge, spin, lattice, and orbital degree of freedom. And due to these competitions, they so variety of phenomena, just like parametric metallic phase, parametric insulating, parametric metallic, anti-parametric metallic. Different phases exist in the materials depending upon their composition. And there, one more aspect in these films or in these materials are they so insulated to metal transition depending upon their temperature range. So if we talk about the resistivity temperature graph, at a particular temperature, the resistance drops very sharply, and due to this, these materials are also called closure maturation material, and huge change in resistivity with the application of magnetic field. And due to these materials are useful in temperature sensors, magnetic field sensors, spintronics, or memory devices. So they are classified into three types of materials, such as large bandwidth magnetites, intermediate bandwidth magnetites, and low bandwidth magnetites. Depending upon the temperature range, if we want to measure high temperature measurements, then large bandwidth magnetites are useful. If we want to measure low bandwidth low temperature measurement, we can use the low bandwidth magnetites. So, depending upon our need, we can use the particular type of compositions. These are the different techniques, and some are very cost-effective techniques and very useful. So from this work, say that this is lanthanum-based magnetites, in which you can say that the, and if you want measurement in low temperature regime, just like 150 Kelvin or 130 Kelvin, low temperature measurement are useful. And low band magnetites can be used for the sensing applications. From this graph, we can see that there is very huge and sharp drop in the resistivity with the application of a magnetic field or with the temperature, decreasing the temperature of the composition. We can see that there is a huge change in the resistivity. Yeah, Vishal? Yeah, just I'm concluding my work in this last topic. Okay, so we can say that the depending upon the temperature, these are the very, very useful materials in which the resistivity can decrease, and this can be used as a temperature sensing devices. And also there is also effect of magnetic field. With the application of magnetic field, they show a huge change in resistance, and that will be useful for magnetoresistive sensing devices. So these materials, which are oxide materials, can be used as a magnetic field sensors and temperature sensing applications. So with this, I can conclude my work. Yes. And I am principal ma'am for giving me this opportunity to present my work. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Manoj. Is there any question, Dr. Vishal?
Then we will be texting sir because we are already running late, so we can go to the next.
Okay. So.
Okay. Thank you once again.
Thank you. So next, in continuation of this segment, now inviting third young scientist, Dr. Surendra Singh from Department of Applied Sciences and Humanities, IGDTUW, Delhi, to deliver his talk. Dr. Surendra, please.
Yeah, I hope I'm audible to all.
Yes, please.
Okay. And I hope my presentation is also visible.
Not yet.
Let me share the screen then.
Yes. Yes, please.
Yeah. Is that visible?
Yeah. Yes, yes. Yes, please.
Okay. So, a very warm good evening to all. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Vishal and other organizing members who are organizing this International Virtual Conference on Science, People, Environment, and Pandemic. Thank you, Dr. Vishal and your organizing team for giving me this opportunity of young scientist talk. I'm Dr. Surendra and I'm assistant professor in physics department in Indira Gandhi Delhi Technical University for Women, which is situated at the Lush Green campus at the Kashmiri Gate of Delhi. So basically our university is the first technical university of women for women in India, which is committed for technical education for women. Now coming to the topic of this talk, my title of the talk is How Science and Technology is Helping Us to Deal with the COVID-19 Pandemic Challenges. And coming from a physics background and that too from a technical university, in my talk, I will not be much discussing about the research on finding the vaccine, etc., or the biological research. Rather, it would be more focused on various efforts that scientists and technologists are putting into developing various sorts of solutions to deal with the challenges of COVID-19 pandemic. So it would be more focused on those technological development that will be making our life easier once the lockdown will open and life will come back to its normalcy. Various efforts within and outside the country are being done by researchers to deal with the challenges of this virus. And I have shortlisted 2-3 of those innovations, which I found very innovative and very having very large potential to affect the lives. So as we all know, COVID-19 virus attacks the respiratory system, and in some cases where the immunity of the person is low, it severely damages the lungs and affects the respiratory capabilities. Now, some of the critical patients in that case needs ventilator support to assist them with their breathing. Now, the biggest challenge this COVID-19 has posed to us is the number of ventilators required are very large because this virus is spreading at very large pace, and the people that are getting affected, number of these people are very large. So number of ventilators required are very large. But unfortunately, our healthcare system is not that much good. Or you can say the number of ventilators that we have in our hospitals are not sufficient to deal efficiently with this pandemic. That means we need more ventilators. Now, this is something that is truly amazing. Oxvent. This is an Arduino-based ventilator that, in fact, I consider this is a very innovative thing that the people from King's College of London have made. This is all Arduino-based, and to those who don't know about the Arduino, let me tell you, this Arduino board is a very simple board, basically a tiny little circuit which is used to teach the coding and electronics concepts in the school and colleges. This rapid prototype ventilator was built by a team of technologists and medics from King's College of London.
Excuse me, Dr. Vishal, is there anyone presenting the screen?
No, ma'am. It's self-explanatory.
Hello. Dr. Vishal, actually I'm presenting through a mobile phone, so I don't know whether my screen is visible. At a time, I can switch to one app only. So I hope my screen is visible to you.
It is not visible now, so please share it again.
Dr. Vishal?
Yes.
Is my screen visible?
No, it is not visible.
Okay.
And Dr. Surendra, can you please come to the conclusions of your study directly, because we are running short of time and we can discuss over this.
Definitely.
If it is possible to you.
Definitely, ma'am.
Can you make it slightly large? It is very... Yeah, please. Now it is clear. Please go ahead.
So basically, this is something that is truly amazing. This Arduino-based ventilator is basically consists of an inflatable bag with some sensors and solenoidal valves to control the airflow in such a way that they artificially assist in breathing and breathe-out cycle. This is not a full-fledged ventilator, rather it is an easy and simpler version of those ventilators which we see in the operation theaters and hospital. But why such kind of ventilators are needed? Because not all the patients are critical. And those patients which are not critical, they could be given support with these kind of ventilators. And these kind of ventilators are called CPAP ventilators, continuous positive airway pressure, whereas those which we see in the operation theater are BiPAP. They are very advanced version, but this simpler version, for which rapid prototyping could be done, could save thousands of life. This is what I wanted to tell you in this slide. And let me take you to the next slide. This is an automatic mist-based sanitizer dispensing unit, which DRDO has made. This is an indigenous innovation, and these are basically mist-based sanitizer dispensing unit, and these machines contains a nozzle that detects the hands using infrared sensors and sprays the sanitizer mist. Now, these kind of devices are very important once the lockdown will open, because these kind of devices can be installed at entrance of various universities, colleges, offices. And in fact, they are very effective in maintaining the hygiene and controlling the corona. So these are some innovations that our scientists are doing. And this is the another innovative product that has also been developed by DRDO in collaboration with Defense Institute of DIPAS, actually, and Institute of Nuclear Medicine and Allied Sciences. Now, this is a UV-based disinfection chamber. And as we all know, UV light is basically a high-frequency EM radiation that has capability to kill the coronavirus because of energy of their photons. They can basically disrupt the bonds. And this innovation is very simple. They have used a UV-based light inside a chamber, which can be used to disinfect various things, such as personal belonging things, files, papers. As we all know, in offices and government and private organization, lots of paper and files from one office to another office passes through the various hands. So that's not something good. Once the lockdown will open, by such movement of paper and files, one can easily catch the corona. So these kind of disinfection chamber can be very effectively used to disinfect the files and various papers that are being used, that are currently being used in various organizations. Now, this is something which is truly amazing. This is a this is a laser-based rapid testing device for testing the coronavirus. And this has been built by Penn State researchers in the Penn State University and New York University in collaboration. And this is basically a diagnostic tool that can rapidly identify the virus using a laser beam, a detector, using the principle of Raman scattering. Now, let me tell you, this is something which is truly amazing. Normally, we use the PCR-based technique, which takes 2 or 3 days and maybe more depending on the number of cases we are handling. But this device can confirm the corona up to 90% accuracy within few seconds. They basically shine the light on the collected samples and detects the reflected light, which has some shift in the frequency. And then they use the machine learning algorithms. In the graph, you can see there are 3 clusters. These clusters are showing the...
Dr. Surendra Kumar, we have a short of time. Can you please conclude it?
Sure. Just last 10 minutes. So these are some other innovations and various hundreds of other innovations which I could not cover. So what I basically wanted to tell through this presentation is these devices have much potential to deal with the COVID-19 challenges once life will become normal after lockdown will open. And our scientists are putting a lot of efforts in developing these devices, and much of these devices are indigenous. As you can see here, these 3 devices are also built by some indigenous researchers. Thank you,
Dr. Suren, for so much useful, informative information. Is there any question, Dr. Vishal?
Yes, ma'am. I'm saying we should carry on with the presentation. I will be sending the questions directly to the speakers.
Okay. So, next is...
Thank you, Dr. Vishal.
Let me invite 4 young scientists talk by Dr. Ritesh Kumar Shukla from St. Xavier College, Jharkhand. Dr. Ritesh. Dr. Ritesh, please.
Yes, I'm there. I'm just presenting my screen. Good afternoon to all of you.
Dr. Surendra Kumar, please stop presenting the screen because we have
just starting it. Now, is the screen visible?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So, good afternoon to the organizing committee and all the members over here, giving me an opportunity to speak on a particular topic. My topic is the use of immunohistochemical technology and other molecular tools in revealing the pathogenesis of COVID-19 virus. Now, we all are aware of the current scenario today. The outbreak of COVID-19 has adversely shattered the global health, economy, society, and the environment, and the ever-increasing number of cases and death is still continuing, and it is creating a havoc. So the world is now struggling to combat against the pandemic, and there is a serious concern to think about the public health and economy, which is currently at stake. Now, United Nations has given the certain guidelines
for combating this. And what this is within the five guidelines, the health first is being kept in the priority list. So we are talking about that. Now, how to protect and safeguard the human life? It's a very common question. We say that identifying the infected individual to testing, isolating them from the masses, then treating those individuals to effective drug and vaccine. This is where the entire world is racing for. And that this drug designing and the vaccine development is largely dependent upon the identification, quantification, isolation, and molecular characterization of the virus. And here comes the role of the technology, which provides the data by which we know about the knowledge of virus, then only we can be able to make an effective drug or vaccine. Now, in previous sessions also, these have been discussed. The molecular techniques for identification, quantification, and characterization of viruses include those of real-time PCR, which is basically involved in the determination of the viral nucleic acid. Then another one, transmission electron microscopy. This is a technique by which the morphology, the shape and size of the virus has been determined. And other qualitative and quantitative estimations such as ELISA, immunoprecipitation, immunoblotting, flow cytometry, and FIT are being used. I'm not going in detail of this part. I'm coming to the next part. Now, what additional information about the virus is essential for effective drug design? The earlier what we have discussed, and now what we are going to discuss, is that for effective drug designing, our knowledge regarding the biological behavior, that is pathogenicity of the virus, is very important. What does it mean? That means virus, how it enters the host cell. What are the specific receptors on the host cells that actually first attaches the virus on the surface? And then the virus is able to introduce its genetic material inside the host cell. Once the genetic material comes inside the host cell, it is responsible for taking up the entire properties of the host cell to replicate itself, to multiply. And then after multiplying, increasing its number, it is responsible for causing the death of that particular cell. This is what we see that the infection cycle. So for designing the drug, these features, right from the attachment of the virus to the cell surface, internalization of this genetic material, the entire cycle which is going on inside it, these play a very vital role, and these, the data, play a very important role in targeting what actual the drug should be designed and which can block these events. For example, the drugs have been designed to block the attachment of the virus to the host cell. They have been targeting, the drugs have been designed, which are responsible for blocking the replication of the viruses. So which technique, number of techniques are there, but which molecular technique will assist in elucidating the biological behavior of the virus? The answer here is immunohistochemistry. Now, this is a novel technique that can reveal even a small quantity of antigen. Antigen here, I'm taking what? The virus we're talking about. At the tissue, cellular or subcellular level. This is very important because virus is getting inside the host cell and causing damages. In situ, by means of specific antigen-antibody reaction, attacked with visual level. We'll try to understand this with this next slide. Now suppose infected patient is there, after that you can take out the lungs, and those lungs are being sectioned into fine section, say 5 to 6 micron thickness. And within that, we are going to add a antibody. This is referred as first antibody. That I've shown over here is, this is the antigen we're talking about. This is the antigen or the virus we're talking about, which is inside the cell or at the surface of the cell at the initial stage of attachment. Now, if we, to that section, if we add the first antibody, which should be specific to that virus, this is the peculiarity or the beauty of our system, we can say, that antigen and antibody are specific in reaction. Now, when we give this first antibody, in order to amplify the reaction, we add, the second antibody, which is specific to the first antibody.
But these reactions are taking from the slide. How can we visualize this? We are not able to visualize. So these second antibody are actually tagged with chromogen. Or not chromogen, it is tagged with enzyme. They are known as enzyme-labeled antibody. Here I have used the term AP, that is particular enzyme is there. Now, when we have added the enzyme, then we add the chromogenic substrate. This is the chromogenic substrate which has been added. When the enzyme binds to the chromogenic substrate, the color develops. Now, if that can be visualized now under the microscope. Now, when we are where we are seeing the color, that means there the second antibody is there, that means there the first antibody is there, and there where the antigen is present. And in each step between these, washing is performed so that the unwounded antibodies are removed out. Otherwise, it will get a false error result. So only the area which is bound, that will remain over there. Then only we'll be able to localize. And if the virus is initially attacking the cell, it is attaching the surface, we can visualize over there, it's getting inside, those color will be developing and will be seen inside the cell. So this is the important technique which is known as immunohistochemistry. And what is the basic requirement for this? The basic requirement is the antibodies against COVID. And number of companies are there.
Sorry to interrupt you, Dr. Rakesh Shukla, Ritesh Shukla. Sir, yes? You have to wind up your presentations a bit soon because we have shortage of time.
Okay, I'm just concluding.
Thank you, sir, and sorry for the interruption.
So these are through the immunohistochemistry, these many viruses have been identified. And this is the coronavirus, which is the outer envelope. And this outer envelope has got these spike proteins. And these spike proteins with which it may be able to make the attachment with the host cell. Now, this is the electron microscopic view where we can find the spike proteins, which is in the form of crown. Therefore, the name goes corona. Now, this is the entire infection cycle there where virus attaches with it. Undergoes the cycle of reaction, produces many viruses, and then resulting the cause of the death of the cell. Now, this is the tissue which has been taken out lungs from the infected patient after the death, and this is showing the necrosis, the death of the tissues. Now, this is the slide which is showing, the arrows are showing at the point where the antibody reactions have been shown and presence of virus has been visible. Now, this is again the slide where the reactions we find, these are the reactions which are referring the infection over the areas. I'm not going in detail of this part. This is the indirect method of actually measuring. Once we can use the antibody against the virus, this is not the case, it's a different case, but we'll not discuss it in the process of time. Now, this is the entire which is showing the process of attachment of the virus. And then when the cells are there, those cells are infected. This is the figure which is showing the soap. And ultimately, I'm coming to the conclusion that for effective drug designing, integration of all the informations from all the following tools are absolutely necessary. Whether it is a bioinformatic tool, whether it is a microscopic tool, that is TEM ion, whether it is the quantification tools, that is RT-PCR, and immunological tools. And lastly, this is also very important, that is immunohistochemical techniques. And recently, these techniques are also being used to identify the viruses. And this viral nanotechnology, as we have discussed so far in many lectures we have heard, this is playing an important role in designing the drug, the vaccine. Now, this, thank you all, be safe. And I can also thank to my mentors and thank to the entire management committee, Charu Sharma Madam, Purnima Ma'am, Dr. Vishal, Dr. Vindana, and all the participants. This is what I have presented, and thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ritesh. With this now, we come to the conclusion of this segment on Young Scientist Talks. At the end of session, I would like to express my sincere thanks to the guest speakers who have enriched our knowledge on the subject, which is so pertinent at this time. I also wish to thank all the participants for being good listeners and hope that the session would have contributed to your knowledge base. In the end, I would like to thank the organizers for conceiving and successfully conducting this international virtual conference, session 4, which is so relevant in present times. Thank you. Thanks a lot for all.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your kind support. Aapke bina ye possible, I would say. So, thank you so much.
आप आए. अब मैम इज चेयरिंग आवर नेक्स्ट सेशन ऑफ यंग साइंटिस्ट फ्रेश यंग साइंटिस्ट टॉक. सो मैम इज वन ऑफ द जजेस एंड अदर जजेस आर देयर एज वेल. सो बिफोर एनी डिले आई वुड लाइक टू इनवाइट आवर फर्स्ट फ्रेश यंग साइंटिस्ट टॉक. दैट इज अभिषेक पांडे फ्रॉम कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन SDNB University.
Sorry to interrupt you, Vishal. Just an interruption. Yes. It is requested to all please mute your mic.
Hello. Am I audible? Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir? Very good afternoon to all of you. This is Abhishek. Am I audible, sir? Am I audible,
yes, sir? Yes, Abhishek, we are audible.
Okay. Very good afternoon to all of you. This is Abhishek Pandey, research scholar at SCSBMB University, Kanchipuram. First of all, I would like to say thanks to Bhagwani Nivedita College for giving this opportunity to present my talk on a study on deep learning technology in early detection of COVID-19 among farmers. Shall I share my slides, sir? Hello?
Yeah, we are doing. Please.
Yeah, I'm sure.
No, sir, is it visible? My slide is visible, sir. Hello?
Give us a minute.
Sir, I shared my slide, sir.
Yeah, we have your slides, just give us a minute. Would you please share his slide?
Sir, may I share from my
slide? It was not visible.
You are may to share your slides.
Shall I share, ma'am?
Okay.
Okay, ma'am, I'm sharing. Ma'am.
Slides are visible.
Ma'am, is it visible, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Abhishek, visible, please continue.
Hello? Is it visible, sir?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Please.
Actually, as we all now abstract of my talk, as we all are aware that the novel coronavirus COVID-19, which first appeared in Wuhan city of China and spread around the world and become pandemic, and it has raised lots of death across the globe. Therefore, we need it is a kind of art to identify automatic diagnosis tool that lead in order to early identify and diagnose the COVID-19 patient. As we especially to safeguard the life of our healthcare providers, medical staff, and our farmers.
From Department of Biotechnology, JIIT Noida. Are you here, Kundi?
Mr.
Hello, Dr. Vishal. Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, I'm sharing my screen. A very good evening to everyone present. The topic of my presentation is nanotechnology and SARS-CoV-2. As we are well aware that in late December 2019, an unexpected outbreak caused a severe acute respiratory syndrome, or we are commonly calling it as COVID-19, which is generally spread by respiratory droplets or aerosols. So as we are facing these lockdown situations and not knowing the exact mechanism of diagnosing or treating it, so there are like the possible ways. I have listed a few possible ways, such as the CT scans or quantitative PCR, ELISA-based techniques, chemiluminescence, and some lateral flow techniques. So there is an urgent need to develop a sensitive, accurate, rapid, and a low-cost diagnostic tool to screen the infected individuals. So there are certain biomarkers or indicators that are there to diagnose this COVID-19 virus. These could be like the lungs, but these are very limited to the hospital categories. Then the very important biomarker is RNA or ribonucleic acids, but the RNA-based techniques, we are generally seeing that are showing the high rate of high false negative results. Another biomarker could be the quantitating the exact antigen or the virus present inside the human body. And we need an ultra-sensitive method for this particular detection. Similarly, we need an antibody detection kits such as IgG or IgM antibody. But these are again prone to give a false positive results. And last but not the least, the certain cytokines or the chemicals that are released inside our body once we get infected or something. But it is at the later stage when you are highly infected. So there is a need of a diagnostic tool which has a high sensitivity as well as reduces the time. So that is where the nanotechnological interventions come in between. I have listed a few common recent developments that are related to the nanotechnology. And the first one is this detection of time, this RNA extraction method. So what the scientists have done is they have developed a polyamino ester with a carboxyl group that is called as PC-coated magnetic nanoparticles for viral RNA extraction. As compared to the traditional method, which takes around more than 2 hours for the detection, these PCMNPs, magnetic nanoparticles, these methods take only 30 minutes and combine to the virus lysis and RNA building in a single step method. And these RNAs and magnetic nanoparticle complexes can directly be introduced in the subsequent RT-PCR reactions. And these are like 10 copies more sensitive than the conventional methods. The other method is development of gold nanoparticles or collide-based lateral flow immunochromatographic strips. These are something very similar to that of your pregnancy test kits or something. So what basically happens is gold nanoparticles collide-based these strips, which are known as a colloidal gold immunochromatographic assay, can detect your antibodies such as IgM and IgG simultaneously. And this could be achieved in within 15 minutes. And the sensitivity is again increased to around 88%. And one again recent development is if we combine these both the methods, so we can increase the sensitivity to something somewhat around 99% as compared to the conventional around 67%. That another recent invention is the plasmonic biosensor. It is a combination of biophysics and biotechnology. And this is like a recent invention for the detection of RNA of this SARS-CoV-2. This is achieved by nucleic acid hybridization techniques using gold nanoiron. Both localized surface plasmon resonance and plasmonic photothermal effects can be used collaboratively, and we can detect like the limit of detection, the LOD value for this particular gene could be around 0.2 picomolars. So it's highly ultra-sensitive method. And but another method that is developed in the same way is lanthanoid-doped nanoparticle lateral flow immunoassay. It is combining the lanthanide series elements, and it's a very rapid and a sensitive detection method which detects the IgG antibody in human serum, and it has again reduced the time to only 10 minutes. So it's a very rapid testing method and it's highly sensitive. So concluding my presentation, the future prospects in the development of nanotechnological intervention could be more handy and easy diagnostic tests. And the formulation, we are talking about the diagnosis, there are developments for the treatment as well. So formulation of drug-loaded nanoparticles, which could treat the COVID-19 disease, which can selectively target the coronavirus inside the human body. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Pradeep. I would say it is to the point presentation and it is very informative. There are questions in the comment box. You can address them while going to the comment box. So let us move to the next. Next speaker is Muhammad Saqib Raza from Dr. B.R. Ambedkar University, Agra. Dr. Saqib, are you here?
Yes, sir. I am audible?
Yes, you are.
Thank you so much for giving me a chance for presenting my views on pandemic like coronavirus. Coronavirus, my topic is the coronavirus, the boost occurs for environment. As the coronavirus pandemic unfold across the globe, threatening lives and upending the world economy, it has also had a profound impact on the environment. Scientists first noticed a decrease in greenhouse gas emissions in China, where the pandemic began. This trend followed the pandemic spread across the world. Let me show my presentation just a second. I think, okay. First of all, we are discussing only four topics. The first topic is the carbon emission, and the second is the medical waste and wildlife habitat and energy. First of all, we are discussing the topic coronavirus pandemic's impact on carbon emissions. Carbon emissions is a very important part of our environment. First of all, comes from the traffic. First of all, first point is the traffic congestions. With the lockdown or stay-at-home orders in effect in countries across the globe due to the coronavirus pandemic, there has been a steep decline in travel and economic activity worldwide. Traffic congestion in major cities fell dramatically as a result. In New York, peak congestion went down 47% from the 2019 average on the morning of March 23. With less traffic comes less pollutants like carbon monoxide. Of course, once non-essential employees are allowed to return to their places of work, traffic congestions and pollution will rise accordingly. Will there be any lasting effect on the environment? The next point is the short-term versus long-term effect on climate change. Unfortunately, this dip in carbon emissions will likely only last as long as the virus does. Actively will ramp up once the pandemic subsides, creating a rebound effect seen in the of other crises, says Spanish newspaper El País and all Indian newspapers like The Hindu, The Times of India, and other newspapers. The next point is coronavirus pandemic's impact on waste. The main concern is medical waste. The huge demand of disposable medical products such as single-use gloves, surgical masks, and empty bags in the wake of the pandemic had created a deluge of medical wastes. In Wuhan, the center of corona, the volume of medical waste is reported to have risen from 40 to 240 tons a day at the height of the epidemic, according to the South China Morning Post. Masks used by the healthcare workers are sterilized and then go to landfill. But Chinese manufacturer Bulk are also making 116 million masks a day by the end of February. It is unknown yet how quickly the public has been using the disposing of these masks, which the government suggests people wear in public like India. Next, the reusable packaging. Plastic packaging is enjoying an increase in popularity during the coronavirus pandemic. Seen as a more sanitary option, shopper spend in Europe and India on packaged food product is soaring. In Italy, consumer spend on packaged mandarins rose over 111% in the week ending of March 8. The next is the online shopping packaging. About 165 billion packages are shipped in the US each year, with the cardboard used roughly equating to more than 1 billion trees, reporting Amazon and meal kit delivery like Blue Apron and just two e-retailers. Next point is
you have to conclude now. Please conclude your
Okay, sir. I am going to conclude in mine. Okay, sir. Just a second, sir. The one of the things that we can learn from the pandemic's effect can the environment is that we can actually have an impact if there were a global effort to do so. It is inspiring how cities that have extreme level of air pollution from India to Los Angeles, people are seeing the difference of what the air and life quality would be like if there were a minimal number of cars and emissions from polluting industries. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. It was a very informative talk. There are questions in the comments box, so please address them there. We are running short of time, so please address those questions in the comments box only. Thank you so much for being part of our event. So let me invite the next young scientist to talk, Ayushi Srivastava from Chaudhary Charan Singh University, Meerut. We'll be talking about COVID-19 effects on environment. So please, Ayushi, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir, you're audible. Am I?
Yeah, you are audible. Please
move. Yes, sir, I'm presenting, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. My name is Ayushi Srivastava, student of Chaudhary Charan Singh University, Meerut. My topic of the talk is COVID-19 lockdown impact on the environment. From the previous talks, we are aware that the coronavirus disease is caused by a virus named SARS-CoV-2, whose size ranges from 26 to 32 kbs. It is an influenza virus which transmits from person to person through respiratory droplets. These droplets, upon close physical contact to infected person or through surface contamination, can result in spread of the disease. Since now it is clear that an infected person might remain asymptomatic for long durations, it is difficult to discriminate between who is infected and who is not. Here, in this image, which is a transmission electron microscopic image of SARS-CoV-2, it is clear that the structure of coronavirus contains spike-like projections, which gives it an appearance of crown. Because of it, it is named so. In the next image, we can see that because of the lockdown, people were forced to stay inside their premises, and only the people who were seen outside were basically the corona warriors, which were helping regulate measures of lockdown. Now, if we talk about the result of lockdown, we can see that the wastewater discharge, which was poured into the water bodies, as shown in the figure, stopped because of shutting down of industries. Also, the ghats were closed, which overall resulted in cleansing of the rivers like Ganga and Yamuna. The waters of Ganga River was claimed fit for drinking after chlorination. Because of which, one such impact was seen in the longer stay of migratory birds. If we talk about the air pollution, it is majorly caused due to transportation and industrial emissions. The data here shows that the number of deaths caused by the air pollution in the year 2017 was very large, suggesting it to be the major concern. Now, what happened to the air pollution after lockdown? We can see on the image in the right that the visibility of the visibility in the environment increased significantly. The pictures taken before lockdown and after lockdown of Connaught Place, Delhi, show a clear difference in the visibility in the environment. Also, the image shown in the left shows a sudden decrease, a very significant decrease in the level of air quality index from the day of Janta curfew, and it decreased further during the lockdown period. The effects of the lockdown were not just limited to these abiotic components, but also the biotic factors were influenced. The reduced human interference helped flourish wildlife, improved water and air quality, helped improve plant growth, and also the disease caused due to air pollution reduced significantly. With this, I conclude that the pandemic has caused extreme loss of human lives, but has also resulted in environmental bloom. And thus, the current status of environmental needs to be preserved. Thank you.
I would say that is a very thoughtful and very nice. Over to you, Krishna.
Now I invite Paras Batra, Panipat Institute of Engineering and Technology, Samlakha Kurukshetra University, and the topic is social economic impact on India defeating coronavirus. Paraswati Amy.
Good evening, ma'am. I'm here.
Yeah. You can start with your book.
Yeah, I'm going to share my PPT.
You can share.
It's visible now. Good evening, everyone. As we know that the world is facing a huge problem of COVID-19, and as per my research, I have done a research on solutions of socio-economic impact of COVID-19 on economy. The Indian economy has faced n number of problems, but as we all know that we have Indians and we are always able to find the solution. So in my research, I have found some solutions for these impact. I have collected data from 100 respondents through Google Form. Now, these are the some problems that Indian economy will face after this lockdown, that is small scale business will very difficulty for setting up because they can't be bounced back, and so many people are working in this area, all those are unemployment. So there is a need to find solution for those unemployment people. Unemployment is one of the major situation which India will be facing after this COVID-19, and economic fallout, less in GDP, less in supply, less in demand, all these are the major problems. So here comes my research work, that is solution. The first and foremost solution is Atmanirbhar Bharat. All these five pillars which are explained by the PM Modi, and now as per my solutions, there is a need for Indian government to work in the sustainable development goals, because agar hamari Bharat Sarkar ne 17 sustainable development goals per work kara, then we will be able to achieve the $5 trillion economy very soon. Now, the first solution is that Make in India ko boost karna hai and women entrepreneurs ko jyada se jyada enhance karna hai through loans. Yes, the solution is 3 mega structure scheme, which I have done the research, because in India, itinerant retailers, construction workers and informal sectors, so many are there and they don't have cash for them. So direct bank transfer is the only solution. It will help on job guarantee, health security and social security life of Indian people. Next is interest-free loans. Yes, it's the right time. When I have done survey, I have done research from the business people that they said that the GST needs to be abolished or restructured, because if the GST tax is restructured in this time, then we can improve the ease of doing business rank, and through this we can also attract the FDI, foreign direct investment for India. And the next is that recognizing tourist place in India, so many tourist places are there which are unnamed and unrecognized, so the government needs to recognize these places. It will solve the problem of tourism, unemployment, economic crisis, economic development and recession. Yes, the next answer of mine is that if we need to be GST recognized, tourist places, all this needs fund. So where does the fund comes from for the government? The most and former solution is monetization of deficit, that government should print more and more currency to tackle all this situation. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Paras. Now I invite Muskan, being Bhagini Nivedita College, Delhi University, and the topic is COVID-19 is engulfing a lot of water. Muskan, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Am I audible and visible both?
Yeah, you are audible and
namaste.
Visible.
Namaste, Poonima ma'am and Vishal sir. So basically, I'm unable to show my PowerPoint presentation, but I'll start with this only. See, what we humans are very famous for is, when we focus on one thing, we usually totally forget about the other. Like over here, we are fighting for the COVID-19. And during that fight, we have totally forget about the water. Now, during the lockdown, what we were thinking that now Earth is relaxed, but no, it was not like that. Earth was still starving and it was running out of fresh water. And let us talk about all the precautions of COVID-19. And if I talk about each and every precaution, like washing hands, washing all the washable materials which we buy from our market, washing our clothes, or even washing anything like cleaning our homes, everything requires water. And due to not much surprise,
we all know that we are only left with 9 years of fresh water. Yes, you hear me right. 9 years. And this COVID-19 has reduced the age to now 8 years and 2 months. Because the consumption of water worldwide has increased and we cannot negotiate the consumption, because if we want to protect ourselves from COVID-19, we have to use water as much as we can, either to wash our fruits or vegetables or clothes or even our body as well. So through this, I want to convey that now it has reduced to 8 years and 2 months, and God knows what will be the next statistics in the coming December or 2021. Now, moving to next thing, you know, it's very important to protect ourselves from COVID-19. But at the same point, it is very important to take precaution to conserve water, to save water, to reuse water. Everybody worldwide is talking about how we can deal with the situation. And now I think all of us have this positive impact in our mind that somehow we can deal with the situation. As said by ma'am yesterday as well, that there is only one 1% less, even mortality is 1% less is there. So, you know, there is no need to worry so much. So during this pandemic, you don't only have to take precaution from that. You also have to take precaution to conserve your water. Now, example, you can use the filtered out contaminated water, the RO, filter out contaminated water, in various purposes. And one more thing to clear over here is washing your hands to 20-30 minutes does not mean that you have to wash it underwater. No, you have to rub your hands with the soap till 20 to 30 seconds, and then you have to wash it with water. And we all know that if we keep this thing in our mind that we need to conserve water, we need to save it, then automatically we'll ourselves invent and discover more than 50 ideas of conserving water. And at the end, I want to say that if we get protected from COVID-19 today, then what about the situation which is going to be coming next? And no government, no vaccine, no lockdown will be able to protect us from that situation. We only have to deal with the situation. And the good news over here is we are still having 8 years with us. And at the end, I want to stop this talk that stay safe, stay immune, and stay with no wastage and less consumption of water. Thank you.
Thanks, Ms. Swan. Thanks a lot for the information. Yes, 20 seconds doesn't mean 20 seconds in the water. Okay, now I invite next one, Dr. Pathuri Naresh from PSCMR College, Andhra Pradesh. Dr. Pathuri, can you hear me?
Yes, madam. Yes, madam.
Yeah, you can start with your
question. Is it audible, madam? Madam, is it audible?
You're audible.
Can I share my slide?
Yeah, you can share your presentation, Dr. Pathuri.
Okay, thank you, madam. Just just wait, madam, please, madam. Is okay, madam?
Now it's visible. Mr. Pathuri, now it's visible. You can start with your presentation.
Okay, madam. Thank you, madam. Good evening to one and all. My name is Pathuri Naresh. I am Assistant Professor of Physics, Potisramlu Chalavadi Mallikarjuna College of Engineering and Technology, Vijayawada. And thanks to the organizers for giving this opportunity. Today, my topic is challenges of pandemics and physics. First of all, what is meant by pandemics? Pandemic is an epidemic occurring over a very wide area, crossing national and international boundaries and affecting a large number of people. Pandemics are large-scale outbreaks of infectious diseases, and that can cause significant economic, social, political, educational, and health disruption. The most new pandemics are originated through the genetic infections, That means the transformation of microorganisms from animals to the humans. Next, the World Economic Forum concentrated on the issues of trade, governance, health, labor, technology, and education and health. The effect of COVID-19 on educational system is the educational system affected worldwide. Schools and colleges and universities are also closed. And effect on science and technology. Almost many sciences, space, engineering and technology institutions and government agencies affected worldwide, but opened several new funding research areas in several governmental agencies around the world due to COVID-19. The COVID-19 crisis has affected societies and economies around the globe and will permanently reshape our world as it continues to unfold. And on impact of economy, major companies, industries, operations shut down already, like Aditya Birla Group of Companies, Turbo, Bharat, like that. And the effect on the political system. Already so many countries suspended their legislative activities and developmental activities and rescheduling the elections due to spreading of coronavirus in Andhra Pradesh. Actually, the data of WHO, according to data of WHO, India already total cases found 2,37,000 around, and worldwide up to now 66,000 around, and already active mode are India has 1,16,000 and worldwide are active mode are in 31,500 remedies already. Actually, by taking some of the preventive actions against the COVID-19, we will dare to live and be the safe. By practicing the physical distance and by washing hands regularly and by maintaining the at least 1 meter distance between the person to person and cover mouth and nose when coughing or sneezing. By avoiding touching and so stay home if you feel unwell. And what is the role of physics on the COVID-19? Physics-based techniques are very useful to determine the structure of the biology. The X-ray techniques determine the structures of biological structures because of the single biological molecules can also deflect through the X-rays. So that is the one of the technique. And another one is the physics scientists are making an electromagnetic face masks called TRIBO-E to fight the against COVID-19 because of it can hold electric charges to resist the entry of infections. And general conclusions. Essential health services must be available to everyone during this pandemic situations, and everyone should be aware of this pandemic COVID-19. If it is necessary, the rapid identification of infected persons to send quarantine and isolation centers for providing the clinical care, and it is necessary to the take an action by the government has to take necessary actions regarding the health of food and sanitation facilities. If available the vaccine, we can reduce the susceptibility. Thank you to the management. And thank you, one and all.
Thank you, Dr. Ravesh.
Stay home and stay be safe.
Now you. I invite Sakshi Bachari Bhagni Nivedita calling. Sakshi, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, I can hear you.
Yeah, you can start with your presentation.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Shiva Choi from Bhagyanagar College. So here my research goal. Short-sighted environmental improvement is the mirage. This is what I mean. It is not able to weigh the pollution. Although,
Sakshi, your voice is not clear. Just check your voice. It's not clear. No, it's not clear yet. Use microphone or something else.
Now my voice is clear?
Yeah. Now it's clear, beta. Go ahead.
Okay. So shall I start again?
Yes,
you can start again, Sakshi. Just start, but a bit fast.
Okay, so short-sighted environmental improvements. This is only mirage during COVID-19. So this really shouldn't be seen as a silver lining. It is not a sustainable way to reduce the pollution. Although air pollution has decreased, but the effects are only temporary. But the long-term economic and well-being impacts of this crisis are going to be devastating. The COVID-19 has led to the abandonment of the many environmental sustainability programs. Countries will be more focused on restarting their economies by funding the industrial activities, and at last it will lead to the more pollution. As similar cases can be seen with 2008 financial crash, there were temporary decrease in the emission of 1.3%, and when the economy recovered in 2010, emission were at all-time high. So data from Sentinel 5P satellite shows that NO2 air pollution level has plummeted across Europe since COVID-19 pandemic, but despite the economic slowdown, greenhouse gases are still being emitted. There is only 0.3% decrease in the global emission reports from the World Meteorological Organization. It's not annual emission in particular which controls the level. I repeat, it's not annual emissions in particular which controls the level, but it's the whole accumulation since pre-industrial era. So humans, there is nothing much to be happy about. Mother Nature is healing. Really, just give it a second thought. In January and February 2020, NO2 values in the eastern and central China was significantly lower, 10 to 30% only, observed for this time according to NASA. But European Space Agency's early March data shows NO2 levels have increased since the normal activity began in China in March 2020. Now it's all about the game of perspective. Like, if you are really positive about everything, then you would see positive things only. So some expert can say that we can meet our Paris Climate Accord goals sooner. So reason behind this, during pandemic, sectors like transportation and production come to grinding halt. Associated emission caused by them is also dropping. But wild must be kept wild, and our crucial steps to protect our environment ambience must remain high, because all our essential nature provides are under increasing stress. And let for once assume that COVID-19 has helped a lot in reducing the pollution, but the only emphatic reason that has helped is helping out the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration to track the locust movement with a bit ease only. A model for tracking air pollution is helping trace the movement of locust swarms, providing early warning to many developing countries. Developed by the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration on the request of the Food and Agriculture Organization. The application is transmitting precise location and time for locust swarms arriving to government in African and some Asian countries, including India. There is a link between the climate change, COVID-19, and the locust crisis plaguing Ethiopia and East Africa and some part of Asia. Warmer seas means more cyclones, generating the perfect breeding ground for the locusts. This is getting worse by the day. The proliferation of desert locusts is linked with the weather dynamics of the Indian Ocean, the warmest of the five oceans in the world. The weather system in the Indian Ocean largely depends on a simple but unpredictable natural phenomena called the Indian Ocean Dipole. That means climate change during COVID-19 is equal to less pollution, which generates the more moisture, and which is very beneficial for the exponential population of piranhas of the sky, that is the locust swarm. So is it so? And now I conclude my presentation with this. Thank you.
Thank you, Sakshi. I would say so much of information at such age, and I learned a lot from your words. And I know you were busy with our work only. You were at the YouTube live room, so you were not able to present initially at your call. So now, since we have came to end of this day as well as the session, so I would like to take opportunity to thank the speakers, the chairs, of the day, as well as of the session. So I start with the morning session. I would like to give thanks to our guest of honor, Professor V.K. Jain, Vice Chancellor, Keshe University, along with our chair, Professor Pradeep Shishidharam, Professor R.P. Tandon, Professor Karen Sarive, Professor Pankaj Kumar Chauhan, Dr. Parag Ghosh, Dr. Monika Kapoor, Dr. Neha, Dr. Shalini Jaiswal. And now coming to this session, first of all, I would like to thank our party for the session, Dr. Vandana Batra. Ma'am, because of you, we were able to conduct this session so nicely. So you are, again, I can say, you turned out to be our party for the day. So thank you so much for being part of our team and helping us so much. So I would like to also thank you, Professor Dev, and Professor Poonam Solotia. So I would say, Poonam Solotia is still here, and she'll be here initiation of this session. So, ma'am, a big thanks to you for being here. She's a professor at University of Delhi Department of Physical Astrophysics. And she is also provost of Rajiv Gandhi Hospital for Girls from 18 till date. So you devoted so much of time for us. So thank you so much, ma'am, for being here. And then I would like to take opportunity to say thank you to all invited young scientists, Dr. Pooja Chani, Dr. Manoj Srivastav, Dr. Surendra Singh, Dr. Ritesh Kumar Shukla, and Dr. C. Naresh from Andhra Pradesh. And all the young students, I will say, Abhishek Pandey, Nikhilesh Kumar Dilwalia, Sakshi Pachori, Kuldeep Nigam, Muhammad Saqib Raza, Ayushi Srivastava, Paras Batra, Muskan Yadav. So a big thanks to all of them. Thank you so much for making it success. And we will be looking forward for all of you for tomorrow session. We will be having two sessions tomorrow. In the evening, we are going to have session pandemic environment. And I am happy to share with you all that Padam Shri Professor R. Vasudevan, also known as Plastic Man of India, is our guest of honor for tomorrow. And we'll be, after sir, we'll be having Dr. Deepika Sharma from Delhi University. Professor R.K. Sharma from South Korea, Professor Radhesham from Department of Environment, University of Delhi, Dr. Alok Srivastava from Ganga Mohan BGS College, Kanpur, Uttar Pradesh. And we'll be having a panel discussion. In panel discussion, we'll be having Dr. Nita from Australia, Dr. Rita Kumar, which is Chief Director and NRDC, and a MIT scientist. In the evening session, the session for the morning, the chair for the morning session will be for the evening session, the chair will be Dr. Anu Sharma, senior faculty from Department of Physics, Marine Engineering College, University of Delhi, and invited talk by Dr. Ratnesh Seth from Columbia, South University of South Carolina, Columbia, Dr. Ruby Gupta, University of British Columbia, Canada. And there will be a young scientist talk conclave where many assistant professors will be speaking about their experiences and about their innovative ideas. And Dr. Shweta Deng from JIIT Noida, Dr. Meenal Dhal from Department of Anthropology and University of Delhi will be the judges for the event. So and then we'll be announcing best young scientist award. So it will be having two categories. We'll not be giving any award to invited young scientists because they are already very well settled in their field. So there will be two categories of young scientist award. One will be of 5 minutes, which we have called as slash young scientist award, and then there will be a young scientist award from young scientist conference. So with these words, I would say namaskar to all of you. Thank you for joining us for the event, and we'll see you tomorrow at the morning session. Please join us and let's hear together Padam Shri Professor Vasudevan, Plastic Man of India, together. Thank you so much for being part of this. And thank you so much, Vandana ma'am, for hearing the session. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. So with these words, I'm signing out and saying goodbye.